A very good evening to all our attendees. Welcome to the concluding session at Entrepreneurs Tech and Innovation Summit. I am Punita Kapoor, Deputy Editor, Entrepreneur India, your host and session lead. Ladies and gentlemen, to build a consumer tech company in India, you really need to have access and distribution to the belly of the Indian market. You can't build a large, scalable consumer tech company just focusing on the top. You need to reach out to the consumers of Bharat's middle class and the lower middle class and deliver digital products and services to them. In that context is our session on the future of consumer tech, wherein we would be discussing about IoT, e-commerce, and food tech. With this, let me welcome on the virtual stage our amazing set of panelists. A warm welcome to Mr. Pranesh Chaudhary, founder and CEO Zunroof, Mr. Shan Cadwell, co-founder and CEO Fresh to Home, Ashish Sharma, MD and CEO Innovent Capital India, Mr. Mukund Jha, co-founder and CTO Dunzo, and Mr. Sahil Jain, co-founder DineOut. Gentlemen, thanks for taking out time to be a part of the summit. As the format goes, we have about 45 minutes or so. We'll have a very brief introduction from each one of you. Let me start with you, Mukund. If you could explain to our audience the technology and innovation you have done in your respective field, and with that, each of our other speakers can follow.
Sure. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Awesome. Cool. So I don't know how many of you have used Dunzo before, but we are essentially an on-demand hyper-local delivery platform. We currently do about 2 million orders a month, present in 8 cities, and largely operate on 3 different verticals. One is commute, where we run a bike taxi product in few cities. Second is courier, which is largely used by small and medium businesses to ship things across town. And lastly, it's commerce, which is our largest vertical, where anything that you want from your neighborhood is available to you at a press of a button, right? And you can browse stores nearby. You can send a delivery boy to any nearby store, and they can purchase things for you and bring it to your sort of house. Especially during COVID, I think we have been able to deliver and enable a lot of folks to get essentials to their house, and has been really fulfilling for us, right? I think tech and innovation plays a key role in Dunzo in every small and big thing that we do, right? Like if you think about what Dunzo does, like essentially we're making your entire neighborhood accessible to you at a press of a button, right? And you can ship and buy anything that you want within your neighborhood, right? It's fairly complex, and the real world has a lot of moving parts, and technology literally makes all of these complexity sort of masks all of this thing for you, right? Hides everything, all of this thing for you, right? Like bringing together all of these moving parts to work in cohesion is something that we are doing through technology at Dunzo, right? Like I would like to say that there are probably like if I were to call out about innovation, there'll be three large parts of it. One has been just making the marketplace work. It's a three-sided marketplace. There's a merchant who's keeping your order ready. There's a delivery partner who's actually delivering the items to you, and there's a user who's placing the order. Right, just to keep the marketplace working in an efficient manner, right? You need a lot of tools and technology and infrastructure to be built, right from location search to discovery to how do you enable sort of fine, precise location tracking for every delivery partner to sort of complex algorithms that run in the background to figure out like who's the best partner to run for your task so that it can be run in the most efficient way. Right, that's been a large sort of continuous effort at Dunzo to sort of innovate sort of every chance that we get. Right. Second, I think has been around digitizing the real world. Like how do you sort of build around all the complexity of the real world? Just to give you an example, when we started Dunzo, there were only 2 entities, a user and a partner. You could send a guy to any store and get things delivered to your house. Right. As we started sort of getting more and more merchants on the platform, we started sort of digitizing the local neighborhood. Right, we realized that the technology penetration at local stores has been like really, really poor, right? Almost non-existent, right? Like they had no standardized way of collecting inventory, they had no standardized way of billing, right? And we had to build a lot of these things ground up for our merchants to sort of really help and enable them to come online, right? And like, how do you really track inventory in real time? How do you track pricing in real time? How do you give this picture to every user on what is available in their neighborhood so they can actually search and get the demand fulfilled has been the second sort of really big thing that we have been doing at Dunzo. There are other challenges, like for example, like it might start raining in one part of the neighborhood, and how do you sort of treat that? How do you sort of detect that in real time? How do you react to that? How do you enable sort of marketplace to function efficiently during those times, especially even during COVID? Like we had to build a lot of things at a very rapid scale, from social distancing to ensuring that there are no more like two partners at a store at a given point of time. A lot of those things had to be built in really short time. Like our onboarding of delivery partner used to be completely sort of physical, and in overnight we had to build out a tool to sort of really onboard them completely online, right? The last part I would want to talk about is scaling, Danzo. I think as you sort of scale whatever you're building, right, like it becomes really important for you to sort of innovate at that scale, right? And technology really sort of plays a big part here, right? Right from like how do you focus on making sure that every order runs perfectly when you're running 2 million orders? Like that is something that sort of technology enables you to do. Right from tracking every order to sort of really constantly optimizing delivery times. When we started, like our delivery time used to be upward of 60 minutes. Now they are somewhere around 24 minutes, right? And a lot of this has been just efficiently running the platform and optimizing at every step, right? And that also sort of helps us bring down the unit economics to enable more and more people to sort of place orders on Dunzo, right? Matching demand and supply has been at scale has been something that's been really challenging and interesting problem for us to do to solve. Like, how do you solve for peaks and how do you sort of balance the demand and supply so that every order sort of gets fulfilled, right? And how do you sort of build integration and sort of technology around third party so that they can sort of directly plug into Dunzo and start selling, right? How do you scale customer sort of support via bots and while keeping human empathy intact, right? I think a lot of those things have been sort of keystone of how Dunzo has been able to scale its experience right from day one. And like they've been very sort of focused on providing the best consumer experience to our users. And I think technology has been playing a very key part in sort of solving all these small and big problems that we are sort of doing this. And also like we are probably one of the only firms in India who is doing this at a massive cross-category scale where we run sort of multiple categories on the same platform and everything is real-time, right? So which makes things even more complex.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Shan, if you could give a brief introduction, please.
I think you're on mute.
Am I on mute? Okay, sorry about that. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay, thank you for that. So I'm Shan Kadavil. I'm the CEO of fresh2home.com. I'm a serial entrepreneur. You know, have spent most of my early gigs in the Valley where I was a CEO for a software company and then started a cybersecurity company and then ended up in games. I was a general manager of a game called Farmville, which many of you have played. And if not, you know, then you are probably the next generation to my generation, right? So there is sort of an age gap. And then in 2015, I jumped on to figuring out, you know, the problem of solving fresh and chemical-free fish and meat. You know, every sort of 7 years or so, the entrepreneur itch gets it into me. And I typically look at sort of new problems. And this time, the problem of sort of India not having, and that's the divide that Punita talked about in terms of the Bharat and India, right? So if you look at sort of how the fishermen or farmers of India, you know, how they take their produce to the end consumer, it's typically through a layers, multiple layers of middlemen. And these middlemen not only add sort of price exploitation and others to the producers, but also add, because India does not have cold chain, you know, most of these change of hands, and it can be upwards of 3 or 4 days in the case of fish from a coast back to your end consumer, you know, there would be addition of chemicals like formalin or ammonia or something of that sort, right? Because how do you keep a perishable commodity fresh and especially something that's as perishable and that decays in 30 minutes as fish or meat? So this is the core problem that we started working on. And then talking about innovation, right? Whenever I look at a big market, and clearly, obviously, the fish and meat market ticked all the right bells. But there had to be something that is different to us that's different from everybody else. So the way that we looked at it is that how can we cut short that 3 days or 4 days of time to potentially 24 hours, right? And that's really the key thing that we started working with. And it became, I think there is a little bit of a disturbance of somebody's mic. So may I request the others to just mute the mic? So just the key problem that we were trying to solve is how do we get the freshness intact? And how do we get the produce from a fisherman who might be in the extreme say Cochin Coast or someone else to say Bangalore within 24 hours time, right? And all of this, just in time for you to get your order right. And the way that we were able to do it is on the front end, we created an e-grocery venture, which is like the fresh2home.com that you probably have used or know it today. We are today the India's largest fish and meat online player. We do about 1 million orders per month. We sell about 1,000 tons of fish and meat in a month. That's, pretty reasonably large size volume. But that's just one side of the equation, right? So on the other side, it's really that technology really makes a differentiator for us on how we solve the sourcing problem. And remember, I talked to you about the middlemen in between, right? Those middlemen are key to how the old economy moves, but they are also adding new sets of problems around hygiene and quality and so on. So what we ended up doing is that we've got a patented technology that we call commodities exchange. And it's essentially like a virtual stock exchange, right? And we've given an app to some of the most remote fishermen across India. So about 1,500 fishermen use our app. It's a very simple app, right? And if you're trying to explain technology to a fisherman, trust me, it's really hard. Because the first thing that you might get is a slap before you try to tell them, how do you use this particular button here and so on, and then try to trade with you, right? So our biggest challenge was to create an auctions kind of app and get it used by all of the fishermen. And then in real time, what we were able to do is, very soon we were able to directly source from some of these fishermen, understand their problems, and then cut off the middlemen in between. So we have probably created, this may not be known to most people, but we probably created some of the world's largest virtual auctions platform. And it's a really massive technology undertaking. And on the back of that auctions platform, we get over 10,000 price bids from various different coasts at any given point in time, right? And there is no human being involved in sourcing, just given the volumes that we do. And it's an AI-based algorithm on the back end that particularly learns from patterns of the past. And then it automatically sources from each of these fishermen. And the biggest challenge there is one of, communicating an app idea to the fishermen, right? Because these are people who can't read or write. And trying to get them to actually use technology, learn how to use technology, and then trade with us has been an incredibly difficult feat. But we've surmounted that challenges. It took us about 3 years for the technology to be stable. We have a US patent around that technology. And then the next challenge then came in is how to do, a cold chain, right? Because essentially the other problem is to move things in India, where essentially cold chain is very small. So we used a lot of IoT. We are able to now manage our entire supply chain way back from the boat it came from, all the way till the source. We can do traceability. And we are also able to manage temperature to make sure that it's between 0 to 4 degrees centigrade all through the entire supply chain of the technologies that we use. But just to summarize, I think it's really about identifying the market and identifying that whether it's a big or small market, and then looking at what differentiator can you bring in. Trying to do the same thing as everybody else is probably a good strategy if the market is that large and it's too nascent. But given the level of e-grocery penetration today, being differentiated and specialized is really what led to a large growth for Fresh to Home. Thank you, Punita. That's all for me.
Sure. Thank you, Shan. Pranesh, if you could share.
Sure. Thanks, Punita. Hi, I'm Pranesh Chaudhary. I'm the founder and CEO of Zunroof. Sushant and I co-founded Zunroof about 4 years ago now. We have been friends for a long time since IIT days and worked in different fields post that. I worked for Capital One and a couple of consulting firms before coming back to India in 2016 and deciding to do a startup together. And Sushant was working with Sunbird Energy all this while, and we had an idea that the supply and demand of electricity in Indian homes is broken. And that's where we can fix both of them, supply through rooftop solar and demand through IoT. Now, as Shan was just explaining, that just trying to do same thing in an industry which is large enough is different. But if you are coming up with a niche idea, which rooftop solar was, you have to create differentiated product. And that was the that was the biggest challenge for us. While the customers understood that solar will reduce the electricity bill, will produce electricity for them, they usually thought there will be batteries involved, there will be some government subsidy involved, and there was no way for them to design the system themselves, right? So the way we started out was we created a design delivery diagnostics app. end-to-end capturing the customer's life cycle. So the first thing that you do is you take one image of your rooftop, upload it to the app, and the app then tells you, using image analysis and virtual reality, how the roof will look post-installation, what sort of panel should you go for, where should you put the panels at, right? If your roof is big enough, what area should you put the PV panels at? All this creates good aha moment for the customer. Once they are there, then once you install the system at the customer's rooftop, that's where the investment relationship from the customer starts, right? When we as an Indian, when we buy a share or a mutual fund, we want to see how the investment is working out. The similar thing happens with solar as well. When you put, you are a homeowner, you put it on your rooftop, you want to know how the system is working out. That's where IoT was the first thing that we came in, and that I'll just talk about the IoT play completely. There is a lot of business innovation that we have done. There is a lot of business model innovation that we have done on both solar and IoT side. But I think for this particular session, IoT is what should be the focus for us. On the solar side, what we did was we created a very Indian version of solar energy monitoring. What it does, it's a very inexpensive device, just measures the current and voltage that is coming out of the solar inverter, and on a real-time basis gives the customer a look into, okay, how is my system performing? It sends you basic alerts like, hey, you are in the top quartile in Gurgaon in terms of solar production, you need not worry, even if it's a monsoon day. If it's a cloudy day, you still don't need to worry about the production of the system. But the maintenance alert, like, hey, your inverter is not working perfectly fine today, this is what you need to do. So that's the first IoT product that we built and put out in the market. And we realized that created a great differentiator for us. We were able to scale to become the number one rooftop solar provider across cities. So we scaled to 70 plus cities in the span of 18 months. And we found acceptance across the country because of this. That's what led us to believe that, okay, if we can think of measuring the production of electricity from solar rooftop system, we can use the same IoT to measure the consumption of electricity in Indian homes as well. That's where we have made 9 IoT devices. All of them work with one single app. All of them are retrofittable. All of them work with Wi-Fi. And this marries with the consumer insight, right? You are not going to use an app just to control your bulb or just to measure the electricity being consumed or just to control your AC. What you need is one app which allows you to do all this. Also, you won't be changing your, let's say you buy one new smart AC. You're not going to change the 2 other older ACs in your house, or you're not going to change the geyser that's already there in the house. So how do you ensure that all these devices work with one single app? That's the consumer insight. That's the problem that we started working with. And the way we did was and the other thing was, how do you bring the cost down, right? You have to make it mass market rate so that everybody in India can actually get a taste of IoT. So we started working on this about 15 months ago. We started with the first device, which is the smart energy monitor. It's a plug-and-play, reads your house every 30 seconds. We use our clustering algo techniques. If I did not know the exact algo, I would have said we use AI to cluster them and then tell you how much is your AC consuming, how much is your geyser consuming electricity. Based on that, you get predictive maintenance alerts, or you get alerts like, hey, your 5-year-old 3-star AC should now get replaced by a newer 3-star AC because you'll save more on that, right? So all these, the IoT devices are retrofittable. Then you have a smart light, smart plug, which allows you to schedule your geyser to go on at a certain time or your microwave to switch on or off at a certain time. We have a TV remote and an AC remote working with the same as well. Then we have smart doorbells and cameras, which allow you to remotely converse with somebody. Even if you are, let's say, sitting in your office, you're able to see who came at your door. Now, we did all this with a target on the homeowner, but as the COVID situation has happened in the last 2-3 months, we have seen a wider acceptance amongst the sharing economy, like the cloud kitchens, the hospitals. And we realized that because we focused so much on the end consumer and we were able to keep the cost low, this is going to help out a lot in the new normal as it is being called, by ensuring that you are able to communicate with the devices in your home or in your workplace without actually touching them through the same app, right? Also, you are able to sense and control the flow of electricity in your homes at a very low rate for you. So that's the product that we have. And another point that we have is that the innovation that we had to make was that in usual startups, or when you make an app, software and is the only angle that you have to be concerned about. When we were building our team, we knew that hardware, software and firmware, all 3 angles need to be looked at. And that's how we have assembled a team, because you have to figure out how do you communicate with the hardware that is remotely in, let's say, in Bangalore, as well as in Gurgaon, as well as in Guwahati, and how do you push updates to them, right? It's doing a software update is much more different than a hardware update. So it has had its own challenges in how do you ensure that you are 90% plus accurate in doing that and still keep the cost low. That's been the kind of innovation that we are still working on. We think we'll be able to add more and more electrical appliances over the course of the next 2 to 3 years, as the case may be in the Indian context. That's been our story till date.
Okay, thanks, Pranesh. We'll come back to you soon. Sahil, if we can have a very quick, brief intro from you.
Hey, hi everyone. Sahil this side. I'm a founder of Dineout. So just to give you quick context, you know, Dineout is now today one of the largest restaurant tech platforms in the country. We work with close to about 25,000 odd partner restaurants in 20 cities. We started off in 2012 before co-founders, and the journey how it started is that, you know, the four of us, we know each other for the last 30 years, and we always had a, you know, passion of, you know, starting our own business. I was in the US, and Ankit was in UK, and we saw that there is an opportunity where there are a lot of platforms which are working in these markets which are not available in India today. And from a future of restaurants perspective, we felt that the time is right where, you know, restaurants will need to adopt technology to understand their business better, the customers better, and ultimately to become more profitable over time, right? So the way we look at the business is, in a very full stack manner, we look at all the problems that a restaurant has, starting from discovery of a restaurant to marketing of a restaurant to the actual technology required inside the restaurant, to perform various functions, starting from yield management to cost management, right? And we've got products for each of these categories, right? So Dineout is our B2C platform, which is something that we started out with, where we enable customers to discover 20,000 plus restaurants, reserve tables, make their bill payments, and take multiple actions. While we've got a B2B tech platform, which we call InResto, which is a completely SaaS-based product, which, you know, kind of enables a restaurant on multiple fronts from a technology perspective, right? So I just quickly want to share my screen and talk a little bit about, you know, how we've been building that technology for the last, 5 years on the InResto side, and how we believe that, you know, restaurants will have to adopt it. And while they have been adopting it for the last 5 years, we see now a, you know, a very clear case in the post-COVID world where that will become a hygiene, right? Or something which is a default for a restaurant to run their operations. Let me just quickly... I hope you guys can see my screen. So how we look at InResto, it's like AWS for restaurants, right? So what we are building as a platform is where the restaurant can own his own customers. There are multiple products through which we can kind of, get the customer to give their details to the restaurant partner, which could be through a reservation management module or a delivery and takeaway module or an in-restaurant digital ordering module, which is finding a lot of relevance in the current post-COVID world, right? Integrating with multiple POS systems, whatever they might be using, so InResto becomes a layer between the POS and the multiple other technology services that the restaurant needs to integrate into. Then owning your own marketing channels, running your own campaign management system, running your own loyalty management, running your own customized offer through the platform. That is something that we enable the restaurant to do from day one, right? So that they can get the customer data and then reach back to their customers, remarket to their customers at a very low cost. And it is very ROI driven, right? Because I can segment the customers based on their past behavior and actually retarget them depending on their past behaviors, right? They can enable their own delivery channels, which could be direct channels through their own website, Facebook, Instagram, or even aggregators like Zomato, Swiggy, etc. Enabling logistics integration for them with the likes of Dunzo, Delivery, ShadowFact, so that they can deliver directly to their customers. Material management systems, where we are, looking to integrate with B2B commerce players like Amazon, B2B, etc., where we can integrate and enable restaurants to order their raw materials, supply chain management materials directly through the POS, right? Because we own the supply chain management module as well, where we can kind of enable that for them. So the idea is essentially to, own To give the restaurant all the technology integration that they need to actually run their restaurant and increase their profitability. The whole idea is, how can we increase profitability, right? So the idea is that, can we help the restaurant acquire all the data about their customers? And on top of that, we've got multiple modules, starting from our in-restaurant ordering module, which is finding a lot of acceptance, where we can help them increase their revenue or do yield management for them via dynamic pricing or upselling, cross-selling products to them. So the question we ask is that, why can't beer be priced at 200 on a weekday versus 400 on a weekend when the demand is higher, right? And can we cross-sell, upsell products to customers on the table, which is more intelligent and, machine learning driven? If a person is ordering a dim sum, can I recommend a combo of a soup along with it and increase the average order value for the restaurant partner and hence the revenue? This becomes all the more important now because with limited capacity inside a restaurant, where restaurants are forced to operate with 40, 50, 60% of their original capacity, figuring out ways to increase their average bill value and repeat rates becomes even more important than previous times, right? So repeat rate is something which is a function of, do-it-yourself loyalty programs, campaigns, where they can run automated campaigns through the platform, becomes extremely important from a restaurant partner perspective. And then from an efficiency perspective, obviously we've got our own POS and supply chain management module, where we help restaurants bring down their pilferage by doing complete recipe management, where we can track that, based on the recipe and the number of orders, what is the pilferage happening and how can they streamline those operations. And some of the largest cloud kitchens in the country use our supply chain management module to do exactly that, right? So that is where we are at.
Thanks, Sahil. With this, I ask Ashish, the only investor in the panel, to share his perspective as an investor and how he's looking at food tech and consumer tech and e-com space. And if you could share some of the startups you've invested in, Ashish. Ashish, I want you to share your investor perspective and share some insights in some of the startups you've invested in consumer tech, e-com.
Okay. So, we are a venture debt firm with presence in Asia. So India is one of our key platforms. And then we have offices in Beijing covering China and Singapore that covered Southeast Asia. Over the years, we have invested in a couple of hundred companies and have been fortunate to, kind of see the journey and invested in it.
I would like to ask the first question to you, Mukund. So Mukund, how hyperlocal e-commerce you think is going to revolutionize the retail experience in the current times?
Yeah, I think there is a massive revolution that's coming. I think everything, especially with given COVID and everything, I think is going to become a lot more sensitized to sort of local retail. I think a lot of the people who didn't have a direct-to-consumer plan, a lot of the brands that we are working closely with right now are accelerating their direct-to-consumer brands. A lot of people during this time have realized the value of sort of having things online and sort of having a separate sort of channel to sell as well, right? So we are seeing a massive shift where large brands are working on direct to consumer and others partnering with multiple of them to sort of enable home deliveries. I also think that home delivery as a trend is going to become really, really massive. We're already seeing that in our demand numbers, right, where the boundary between sort of you experiencing something sort of ordering something is sort of going to start getting bridged a lot, right? And I also think that a lot of the sort of experiential things will remain in physical retail, but a lot of the things which are more commodity will start moving to more and more e-commerce and hyperlocal commerce like Dunzo, where as the trend progresses, like, things that are commodity will start moving to more and more e-commerce and hyperlocal commerce, and spaces will largely sort of remain for experiential buying, where you need to go and experience certain things, right? It's also too early, and I think as humans we have tendency to sort of overproject something long term, right? But from what I'm seeing right now, I think some of these things which are long-term trends which were going to happen in probably next 5 to 6 years are going to get accelerated and probably will happen much sooner, right? I mean, we're already moving in that direction, but I think COVID is just going to accelerate that, where things will become more and more omni-channel, and local retail will be a lot more about experience than sort of every form of fulfillment. Would love to hear if anybody else has any thoughts on this.
Sorry, I got disconnected, Punita. So I missed the question. Sorry.
Same here, okay, Punita. Sure. I got disconnected as well.
Okay, no worries. I'll ask the question once again to you, Sahil. So, Sahil, how food tech and cloud kitchens are set to change our eating in and eating out? Can you share your perspective on that?
Right. So, see, I think food tech is going to change in the sense that obviously there is going to be a significant shift towards, ordering in, which is home delivery, and takeaway. Like I said, takeaway is going to turn out to be a new category which is going to grow in India over the next couple of years. It had already been a large category in the US and Europe, but I think people will find a lot more comfort, especially in the next 6 to 8 months, where takeaway as a category will grow. And restaurants will have to adopt to that in terms of menu engineering and refiguring out their menus as to what will be the right menus to kind of, manage that as a category. And even in-restaurant ordering, I think, is going to shift away from physical menus to more digital forms of ordering, not just because of, COVID or due to, hygiene factors, but even post that, I think it is just far more convenient from a consumer perspective. And from a restaurant perspective, it gives them a lot more data to understand user behavior based on which they can run, yield management things and specialized combos. So like I mentioned, dynamic pricing is not possible on a physical menu. And all other, channels, if you look, let's say hospitality or airlines, have used dynamic pricing as a great tool to do yield management. So why not inside a restaurant? So I think over time, restaurants are also going to kind of adopt that and kind of move in that direction. So that's how I think the industry is kind of set to change from a technology adoption standpoint. And obviously, there will be changes around, packaging, menu engineering, because, hygiene will become top-notch and most important, from that perspective. And one last part, which is very important, is from a supply chain perspective, I think is going to change a lot because, again, as hygiene and quality of product becomes important, I think restaurants will focus a lot more on that. Customers will focus a lot more on that. And that also is set to change from the current offline processes and, where a lot of uncertified vendors are providing, material to restaurants. I think that is also going to change over the next couple of years.
Thanks. Ashish, do we have you back? Can you hear us, Ashish?
You're feed on, so I think I hope you can hear me.
Yes, I can.
I can hear
so,
you, yeah.
If you could share your perspective on what are some of the opportunities and challenges that aggregated platforms like Swiggy and Zomato face, and how do you see the space evolving over time? I think we have lost him again. So with this, I move to you, Pranesh. Pranesh, can you share some of the challenges that block the growth of IoT startups in India?
Challenge has been on the supply side for us more because demand, as I was talking in my introduction as well, we initially focused only on the home, but during the COVID, we realized that there is a lot of demand coming from the cloud kitchens and the hospitals and the clinics as well, right? Because people don't want to touch the food force. So the supply side, where the supply lines are broken almost for us, all the factories were almost not working during the lockdown. So it's been difficult for us. We depend a lot on the contract manufacturing of our PCBs and to assemble them into the final product. And still early days, even though Unlock 1.0 is in progress, we're not seeing our vendors and suppliers back to their full quota of strength. So that's going to be the biggest challenge for us over the next 3-4 months to see how we can reduce some of our dependence on the chip manufacturers for us or on the PCB assemblers for us. Apart from that, not much has changed. The demand side, as I said at the beginning as well, it has only picked up.
Sure. So one common question to all of you, with Jio entering the space of e-commerce and hyperlocal in particular, I mean, do you think that's going to have an impact on entrepreneurs, or do you have anything to worry about?
I think, you know, with Jio coming in, it's just going to make the market bigger, right? I think their entire spiel is to make it, you know, available to the masses, right? And ensure that a lot of the people who don't understand technology eventually come onto that technology and start using it. So I think from that, our perspective is that, you know, that's just going to make the market even larger, give new opportunities to SMEs and businesses to scale up their businesses. So I think that's good in a way, right? I mean, even when, like if you go to the cab era, right, when Ola started, when Uber came in, it actually expanded the market rather than cause a challenge, right? So I think from that perspective, I don't see that as a threat. I think it's more of an opportunity, I guess, for everyone. That's my perspective.
Chan, would you like to add to it?
So I kept going in and out. So I apologize if, you know, I lost some of the trail. But from a COVID perspective, you know, we think this could potentially be the demonetization moment for anything online, right? So similar to what demonetization did to the fintech, from a startup perspective, e-grocery in particular and also delivery is seeing a huge growth. And I think this is sort of people, you know, not familiar with sort of how this played out in China or the others would think that this sort of is a peak that will come back to the old normals when COVID comes in. But I think this is simply a switch from an off into online behavior. If you look at sort of,
yep.
China, we see about 5.5% of the market are online, right? And India is less than 0.3% or even lower for an e-grocery perspective. So, if you just look at if you are able to offer a solution that's sort of, you know, at least suited to sort of the lower side of the average Indians in terms of mass premium pricing and also manages the quality, I think we are in for taking that 0.3% to a 5 or 6%. And that's a huge number, right? We are talking about $600 billion of consumption and about 5% of that is a huge number. We may not all see it going to all of the platforms. In China, it's typically the mom and pop shops which launch, you know, the small stores on WeChat. It could happen in India the same way. They could be large players. They could be a combination of platforms. They could be new entrants like WhatsApp. It could be the Facebook shop or others that might disrupt the industry. But overall, I think this is definitely a sign for taking the offline industry to online.
So, Mukund, what's your view on that?
Yeah, I think very similar views. I think it's market expansion and also, like, currently we're spending so much energy and time in educating the users about what's possible online. I think Jio comes and accelerate that for everybody. I also think that grocery, like, especially a marketplace model in India is really hard, like, where, like, quality is a big concern, like, you know, like how sort of, Big Basket and other people have been able to manage quality by having warehouse. And I think the whole marketplace mode that Jio is taking right now, like, I think we'll have to watch if the quality is something that they're able to maintain. So I think, we're like very excited about the move. I think it expands the market for everybody, increases visibility. And overall, it's a great thing for consumer, right? Like, they get more option, pushes everybody else to like really do better to serve the customers.
Sure. With this, I think we'll open the floor for questions as we are running short of time. So, Sahil, we have one of the questions from Harshit Kar for you. So he's asking, can you give more insight into the B2C model of Dineout, like the revenue model you have adopted?
Right. See, the revenue model for us is pretty simple, right? On the Dineout side or on the B2C side, we send business to the restaurant partner. So for every transaction that we're able to drive for a partner restaurant, there's a simple sort of commission model for discovering that restaurant, right? So either the customer could reserve a table or could be transacting at a restaurant, which could be a QSR, it could be a food court, it could be a fine dining place. For every transaction, we charge a commission. And that's the discovery fee that we charge to the restaurant partner. Other revenue models are obviously around advertising and marketing services. So the other thing that we also enable the restaurant to do
is to do very effective ROI-based marketing, right? Where I can clearly tell the restaurant that if you're spending 50,000 rupees on marketing, I was able to deliver 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs worth of transactions at your partner restaurant, right? Which is something other marketing channels are unable to kind of give to a restaurant, whether it is even a channel like a Facebook or a Google for that matter. It doesn't really tell you what was the transaction that they're able to drive inside your restaurant, or even other channels which are offline like print, you know, print media, radio, etc. They don't really deliver that to you, but we as a channel partner are able to give a very focused, targeted based marketing service to the restaurant partner. So these are the two major revenue models on the B2C side. Plus, we are also able to kind of club in our B2B SaaS products into our B2C model and kind of cross-subsidize that, which we are able to do to a large extent and leverage both sides of our products while selling to restaurant partners.
Sure. There's another question for Ashish. It's from Akhil Ahuja. He's asking, do you think after this pandemic, investors would be interested in investing in leisure-based startups dealing in travel and tourism industry? Ashish, are you online? Can you hear us? I think he's not there. If any of you would like to pitch in?
So I think, like, from an investor perspective, I think it's going to be a hard time, right? For the next 6 to 8 months, it is going to be hard for folks to get investment, especially as per the question on the leisure and hospitality side. But I think some of the stronger guys who already have built a brand should be able to get, you know, follow on investment, because see, in the current times, people will trust brands which have already been created, right, from a safety hygiene perspective and anything of that sort, right? So folks who have already built a brand over the last 3-4 years, I think for them to get follow on rounds, etc., should be much easier versus a brand new guy starting up trying to create a brand at least in the next 6 to 12 months. That's my view on that, at least.
So with that, we'll just have a parting note from each one of you. Pranesh?
Yes, it's great to join this and get a perspective from some of the names that I've always used, like Tanzo or Dineout. Great. I didn't hear a lot about the IoT perspective, but I would love to touch base with Sean and Kyle and see what are the use cases that they see for IoT in their spaces. Apart from that, I don't think there are a lot of startups which are focusing on real revenues and real profits instead of just focusing on the growth side. So it becomes difficult for me to find the right peers, which I could see from the development lack of interest of questions about the actual hardware, software from the kind of business which we are. So, yeah.
Sure. Thanks, Mukund.
Yeah, I think it was a pleasure coming here. Thank you so much for inviting us. I'm going to do a personal plug and say that we are hiring and very aggressively. So please, if you're interested in technology positions, do let me know. Thank you so much for inviting me. It was a really good time interacting with everybody.
Thanks, Sean.
It was a great session. Got to know a lot about stuff that I did not know before. Thank you for inviting me. And I wish all the best for the remaining sessions.
Sahil, a parting note from you?
Yeah, I think it was a great experience being here, talking to everyone and understanding how everyone is dealing with the current challenges and what are the new opportunities. On a parting note, I think this is a great time from a someone who's looking to start up, not from a funding perspective for sure, but from a number of problems or opportunities that have arisen because of the current situation. There are a lot of new use cases which have come up, which can be solved for, and there is a natural progression because of the current pandemic, etc., where people will need new solutions, right? Whether it's the consumer or whether it's a merchant, there are multiple new opportunities to explore and kind of build on. And I think that is something that young folks who are looking to kind of start up can focus on, because the adoption will be high, right, because of the current situation. And if they can get that product market fit right, I think there's a opportunity where a lot of entrepreneurs can come out of this current situation. So that's my parting note on this?
Thanks for this. I can rightly conclude that the way you all are building digital products and services on top of it that can really help the digital economy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pranesh.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mukund. Thanks, Sahil. Thanks, Shan. Thanks, Ashish.
Thank you. Take care. Bye.